Related to workplace communication. Abdul.
Interview.
Interview. Salary. Yep. I need to my salary to be increased. Now, in terms of applying for a job in Australia, what do you think? There's no sort of right or wrong here. What do you think is the way people in Australia apply for a job? It's Mohammed.
Work experience.
Work experience. Okay. Some of you did work experience last year, didn't you?
Yeah.
What about how people found jobs in the countries that you've come from?
It's in my country, Miss, it is who knows you.
It's who knows you?
Yeah.
So if I know you, I'll just get a job?
Like, Miss, if you go apply for a job,
yeah,
and I go and apply for a job, if that person knows me, even if you have the work experience than me, they don't know you, you go.
Wow, so even if I didn't have the work experience,
yeah,
because you know me, I'd get the job.
Yeah.
That's not bad, huh?
If you have money, you can just pay people to get a job.
Yeah.
Yes.
You pay somebody?
Yes.
Yeah. Pay the position.
Oh,
yeah. Pay the position, you buy the position.
Or if you're connected, like.
Don't we call that a bribe?
Yeah.
Miss, in my country, Miss, sometimes if you're a lawyer and I'm a doctor, and your son, Miss, wants to be a doctor and my son wants to be a lawyer, you give my son position, I give your son a position.
And Miss, sometimes even if you're not that good to be a doctor, they pay money to the teachers to make you pass the exams.
Yeah.
Or maybe you can buy the exams from the teachers.
Yeah.
I'm not selling you the exam paper.
Miss, not so funny, said you'll sell them.
Sorry.
Welcome, Holroyd High. Great to have you here. Thanks for coming. I was interested watching that, just how different some of your backgrounds, where you come from, is to what you're learning at school. Would anyone like to tell me a little bit about that? I mean, the kinds of things you noticed when you started going to Holroyd High that were different?
Yeah, Holroyd High School is a multicultural school. It's really small, so everyone knows each other. Like, we all talk to each other, we know each other, we have fun. Most of us know each other here, so yeah. Sammy would know about the school.
Sammy knows everything.
Why do you know everything, Sammy?
Also, everyone around the school is just friendly. Like, there's never nothing that goes wrong. Nothing goes wrong?
Nothing goes wrong. Okay. Okay, who wants to pick up on that?
Except for Sammy.
Yes, up here.
Holroyd is a very unique school and it's like built up with different culture. There are like 60 different culture and they're all coming all over the place. And they just build up the Holroyd and they're just working together and they studying together and they're hanging out together at that place.
Now, you're originally from Afghanistan, is that right?
Yes, I am actually from Afghanistan and I came to here when I enrolled myself at Holroyd High in 2012.
How old were you then?
I was around 14.
And you came to Australia alone?
Yes, I came to Australia by myself. My parents has died by Taliban when they came and they took my parents and they killed my parents. So I thought like it's better to leave the country instead of dying. And that's why I said, well, I am going. I will go somewhere which I can feel like I am belong to this place, which I can feel that there is a secure.
So you arrive at Holroyd High, you're 13 years old. Could you speak English?
No.
I
was able to speak English not really well. But I was like a bit, like, let's just say 20%, not even 20%. I don't know, you can, because Mrs. Kleinbert was my teacher, so she knows.
What I'm interested in, though, is what it was like for you when you first arrived there at 13. What happened when you arrived at the school? How did you feel?
In the whole entire my life, I never been to school when I was in Afghanistan. So when I came to in Holroyd High, I feel like a home, to be honest. And I see the teachers, and I saw the teachers and principal, deputy principals, and everyone, the students. And I said, like, this is my home.
What about your story, Zara? Tell me your story, Zara.
Well,
you're originally from Afghanistan too, yeah?
Yeah, my background is from Afghanistan, but I wasn't born in Afghanistan. I was born in Pakistan.
Okay, tell me about when you arrived at Holroyd, Zara. What was it like for you?
Well, it was very difficult for me.
When did you arrive?
1.5 years.
And what about the school itself? Like, when you arrived, how did you feel about the other kids at the school? And did you feel like you fitted in or not?
I feel very scared because I never see many people from different cultures. It was very hard for me to take Justin Holroyd. But slowly, slowly, I understand that it's such a great environment. Like,
anyone else want to describe the school for me? Maria, do you want to describe it for me?
Our teachers are different because we ask them a question 2 times, 3 times, 4 times, and they don't get tired or they don't get bored, they don't get angry. They keep explaining it. They keep giving us details, and it helps us to improve, obviously.
Does everyone think that's right?
Yes.
Whoa, okay, right. We've got that sorted. anyone else want to describe the school for me? Just quickly, let's whip around. Yeah.
I'd say Holroyd High, it's like a huge family of different ethnicities and religions and different types of cultures. It's pretty amazing. Like, all the teachers, they, like, welcome you in. It's
pretty
nice.
Why does it work, do you think?
The school, basically, the way that they teach us, the way that they basically run the school is that, you know, everyone's the same. It doesn't matter if you're born here or you're born there, everyone's the same.
Hello, what did you want to say? Here? Yes.
What I've noticed a lot about Holroyd High is that, like, the small classes, the teachers, like, they pay more attention to the students. So which means, like, no matter, like, how hard, like, you're struggling, they're always there to help you every step of the way. Like, no one's left behind. Everyone's always moving forward.
Yeah. Fahim, what happened when you got here?
The first time I came and I see a lot of people are saying hi to me and they are different countries and I can't believe I can learn English and I can learn something in a school that was like, I did it in a dream.
Do you still think it's a dream?
Yeah.
I'm interested too in the way the world outside sees the school, or other schools see the school. Now, the school has a nickname, doesn't it? Outside.
I don't know why it's this, but it shouldn't be called it. It's called Import High. I went to a school called Grey Stains. I wanted to go to Holroyd High. It was just amazing. My friends went there. And then I told the guys at Grace Danes, like, no, don't go to Import High. I was like, why?
Taylor, yeah, what did you think of the school before you arrived there?
My first opinion was, it's full of imports. Like, why would I go? Like, well, I wouldn't belong
imports
there.
Imports meaning people from other cultures.
Yeah, people from other cultures. And, like, I wouldn't belong there. I'm true blue Aussie. Like, I wouldn't belong there.
So has it shifted your attitudes?
Yeah, like, at school, at, like, where I was at school, I hated school. I never went. I used to, like, miss class all the time. And now I've never missed a class at Horrid.
We have a bullying...
Sorry, what did you say? What did you say?
She's much nicer now. Like, she's really nice to me.
So what was she like before?
She was angry, always angry.
Is that right? Were you angry?
Yeah, I was a very angry person, and now that I'm, like, at a school that I like and I'm happier with myself and my surroundings, I'm a happier person.
Okay, is there anything you don't like about school?
Bullying. Sometimes it happens.
Sorry, go on, Zara.
Sometime in the school it's happened that other students, they just knew more English, like they speak very well, and they just make a joke for us that we are speaking wrongly, our sentences are long, blah, like many things. But the rule of our school is that our teachers are very strict about the bullying because they care about it.
Can I just say to you, your English is fantastic. For a year and a half worth of learning English, it's amazing. Anything else people don't like about the school?
Maybe it's the hygiene in the laboratories. That's what I don't like. I don't like how it's a very messy environment.
Yeah, okay. Anything else? Yep.
One thing I don't like about the school is that it has a lot of gum under the table.
Too much. Gee, that's a big problem. Okay. Yes. Anything? Yeah. Yep.
Sometimes the teachers are tough.
Sometimes the teachers are tough. Let's talk about learning English for those of you who've had to learn English. How many of you have had to learn English in, say, the last 3 years? Hands up. A write-up so that we can see.
You're learning right now.
Okay, so that's in the last 3 years. Now, you're from Iran. You came here after a couple of years in Turkey. How long ago did you start learning English?
5 months ago.
5 months ago. Did you have any English at all?
No.
And you're at the Intensive English Centre at Holroyd at the moment. What's that like? How's it going?
Like, it's good. Like, we are all learning together. Like, it's like a family. Because, like, I don't feel nervous when I, like, speak English in the class. Because I know when I make a mistake, that my friends will told me, like, that's not correct. So I will correct it and we're all learning together.
Have you really only been learning English for 5 months?
Yeah.
Yeah, you're doing incredibly well. How did you learn so quickly?
I don't know, because I just speak to my friends and I just, like, practice in home, start speak English with my friends, even if they speak my language. So that's, like, how I've learned English.
I know, Moba, you found some of the language here a bit strange. Tell us the things you found strange.
Friend told me that, like, I know this place, like, back of my hand. I was like, it doesn't even make sense.
Knowing then, somewhere like the back of your hand. Do you know what it means now?
Yeah, I know. Like, because you always look at your, like, back of your hand. Yeah.
Yeah. And what other things?
Hit the frog and toe.
Hit the frog and toe.
Yeah. I don't know what does that mean.
Okay, it's rhyming slang. It means hit the road, which means to travel, to, you know, move. Okay. Road rhymes with frog and toad. It's really hard to explain.
Which word there do you see many times?
Happiness.
Good, happiness. Okay. Why are we speaking in Arabic?
Of those of you who are learning English, who have parents at home who don't speak English? Okay, so you're going to school to learn and then you're going home. Yeah. How, what's that like? How hard is that?
The English is very hard to
it's
learn.
It's a very hard language
and
to
the
learn.
Sentences. And I'm always talking to my mom. She's always telling me, shut up, no, no more English at home. Just leave English in your school, please.
In my opinion, talking English is harder for our parents, who they should try to learn English, for example, in year 40 or 45, and that's really hard for them. But we are young, we can learn English fast. And
Nazreen, what does it mean for you with studying? How do you manage?
It's so hard. Like, you have competition. Like, I should study until 4 a.m. morning, and it's so hard. Like, other students, when teacher
you
told
study
them...
You study until 4 in the morning. When do you sleep?
No one believes me. No one.
When do you sleep?
I sleep maybe 3 hours a day. I'm not lying. Really. No one believes me. Like, every student, when teacher says them, like, something, they know. But for me, I should take a dictionary, I should find every word, then I'll know. Like, it's so hard, like...
So do you take notes in English, or do you take...
Hilal, he knows. He's in my class, and every single word that teacher says, I have another notebook for notes, and I'll write everything there. Most of them are... My spelling is not good, so I should go and search it and write it, and it's so hard because I'm...
So you do this every day?
Every day. And it's boring. It's really boring.
How much pressure do you feel under to do well at school?
Lots.
So much. Yeah.
And where does that pressure come from?
From school.
Okay, one at a time. Mahana?
Teachers.
Well, how much pressure do you feel to do well, and where does that pressure come from?
The pressure comes from our parents and our culture, because our parents have a really high expectation of us.
Okay, the so pressure... it's coming from the parents. But Ruth, you're saying it's you're not getting pressure from your parents.
No, because our parents don't go to school. Yep. So it depends on where you want to be and how hard you want to work.
So you're from Sierra Leone?
Yes.
Actually, your parents aren't with you, are they?
No.
No. So you're living with a friend here?
Yes.
Yeah. And had you been to school before you came to Australia?
No.
Ever?
Never.
So how old were you when you arrived?
12. If you want to like learn English, you need to stick with people that know English. First time that I came, I watched movies, English movies, and speak to friends. Okay. That's how you learn English.
Yes, Bashir.
The way I learned actually English was quite different. Where I learned English in detention center, where I was, I didn't have a teacher, I didn't have a book, I didn't have a pen, a pencil. I borrowed a dictionary from one of my friends. I borrowed a pen from other friend, pencil borrowed from another friend, and then from there I start learning English, and I was like learning 15 words every day.
This was while you were in detention?
This is where I was in detention center, yeah. So I thought like, I'm gonna learn a language which can help me later on. And then I start learning English, and then from there, yeah.
Well, I want to tell about background, like in Afghanistan. I think I don't feel Afghan people, like I don't understand them, because I think some of them are like, their stories are not true. But I have been in Syria. I have been in Syria. I have been in Syria and have seen people like child, they are getting bombed like in the war, like last 2 years.
Yeah. Those people, I think Zara wants to say something about this.
I disagree.
I'm totally disagree to Tahira. She's telling that because our story is like not true. If is it not true, so why are we gonna leave our country, or why are we gonna come there? If she don't understand, if she didn't understand the Afghan people, so it doesn't mean that we have a...
Sorry,
it doesn't mean that...
Like, no, I want to let her finish.
Badly in like Syrian people. I have seen like blood in front of my eyes, like children that are dying for no reason. They have no problem. I know their situation was bad, but not as bad that Syrian people they had.
Tell me your story. How long ago did you come to Australia?
I came like the end of 2012.
Yeah. Okay, so quite recently.
My father was here, so when war started in Syria, my father forced us to come here because...
And where did you live in Syria?
In Damascus.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
So every person every country has their own difficulties. Exactly. Like in Syria, there is, like in the whole world, every Every country has their own problem. It doesn't mean that their story is wrong. It doesn't mean it's not fair, miss. Hang on a minute.
I think we might move on. just quickly, though, I wonder what else some of you have learnt about one another's cultures. Taylor?
I feel like I didn't know half of the cultures before I came to this school. Like, I knew, like most of the, like, normal ones, and then I heard, like, so many different ones, and now, like, our multicultural days are absolutely amazing. If anyone wants to come to a multicultural day, you come to one at Holroyd High.
Well, I think that Australia and the school wouldn't be the same, and we wouldn't have the same perspective on it if there wasn't people from different ethnic backgrounds.
Has anyone felt pressure to fit in some way?
Yeah.
Not really.
Well, as an Afghan, people, like, because of the stories that they've heard on the news about refugees and Afghans in particular, people would look at me and be like, you're Afghan. They'd judge you. Whereas, I know I'm Afghan, but I consider myself as Australian because I was born here and I know everything about Australia, like the back of my hand. So.
Yeah, okay. Anyone else felt pressure to fit in at school? Is there any pressure to fit in at school? Yes.
For the first few months that I was coming at school, it was like so weird for me. I didn't know what to do. I had completely lost myself among all the cultures, all languages. Like, there are many backgrounds in this school where you don't know to whom you should make connection with. It's so hard for you. I was just feeling dizzy. Where is it? Who are the people? At the first few months, it was really hard for me to communicate with the students around me.
Okay, anyone else about fitting in? Yes.
Even though I was born in Australia, when I was growing up since primary school, I found that no one really liked me and no one wanted me to be around them. And so I kind of grew up with this feeling that I'm not wanted, I'm not needed. And then as I came into Holroyd, I just felt like the atmosphere, as I said before, and now I'm friends with almost anyone. It's weird.
What about in the playground, though? I mean, how do you mix in the playground together, Bashir?
Last time it was like Chinese people goes with Chinese people and speaks Chinese. I see students. Iranian goes with Iranian and speak Farsi. Afghan goes with Afghan and speak Farsi. All of the cultures and all of the countries goes together and speak their own first language because they're scared of speaking English. And
so this is in recess.
This is in recess for IEC students, not for high school students.
Okay, for the intensive English centre students. So they're the ones who are learning English. Ruth, you came to Holroyd and then you moved to a different school. Why did you go back to Holroyd?
Can I tell you?
Can you tell me?
Yeah. Because I don't want it to be like, do you think going to a new school will change and get new friends? But it's wrong because we could, our old teachers, old friends are good and.
Oh, yeah. Was that what it was like, Ruth?
Yes.
Yes. Okay, he's got it. He's got it. He knows you really well, yeah? Why did you go back?
What didn't you
like about the school that you went to after you came to Holroyd?
Because there was no different background, like all Australians, which I don't know how to say it, but...
Australians meaning...
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Because there are all sorts of different Australians. What do you mean by Australian?
How's it? Sorry to say that.
Okay, so like Anglo-Australian.
Yes. Yeah.
So it was mostly, it wasn't as multicultural.
Yeah.
And why didn't you like that as much? For him, you cannot keep answering for her. You've got to give her a chance to answer. Go on.
Because they actually don't pay attention to you, like Holroyd. They don't actually care about you.
Can I add something?
Yeah.
I live very far away from school, and my parents tried to move us to a school that's near to our home, but we refused that because we were afraid to face the same difficulties that Ruth may have mentioned now. Because it's like a bit hard for us to finding ourselves with the Aussie people, like a school full of Anglo-Saxon.
Mm-hmm.
If you go to school that only has one race, you'll feel like you are different. And we're not going to be comfortable there.
Mm. Okay, because there are some Anglo-Saxons at Holroyd. Yeah, I'd like to interview.
Yeah.
But you obviously get something out of that too. What did you want to say?
Yeah, Tanner and I, we're like Anglo-Saxon Aboriginal.
I'm part of them too, eh?
Yeah, all right. Yeah. There's not a lot of Anglo-Saxons or Aboriginals here. We are actually the minority here somehow. But
what's that like?
Minorities in this school.
Because there's not.
So what? So what's that like? Feeling like that?
We honestly don't mind it. I mean,
the only thing we don't like is when like you walk past someone and they start talking in their language and you're like, I'm sorry, but we don't understand you. Like we want to understand you. And sometimes it's sort of like a clash because we don't know what they're saying.
Yeah, well, everyone here, like, coming from overseas, like, they've learned English. I've actually learned Arabic in Holroyd High School. I don't know how, because my parents are originally from Iraq. So, like, I've actually learned Arabic from the friends around, because, like, my Arabic is not that strong. And, like, it's gone stronger ever since I came to Holroyd.
Seems like everybody got a prize. I wonder how to sleep at night.
Fighting disobedience, not listening to teachers, chanting.
And do you still do those things?
No, when I came here, the school changed me.
Everybody got a prize. I wonder how to sleep at night. When the truth comes first and the self comes second, just stop for a minute and smile. Why is everybody so serious? Acting so damn mysterious. Got shade in your eyes and you're here so hot. You can't even have a good time. Everybody look to the left. Everybody look to the right. Can you feel that here? We're painting love tonight. It's not about the money, money, money. We don't need your money, money, money. We just wanna make the world dance. Forget about a price tag. Ain't about a, cha-ching, cha-ching. Ain't about a, but playing. Wanna make the world dance. Forget about a price tag. Ain't about a, cha-ching, cha-ching. Ain't about a, yeah. But playing, wanna make the world dance. Forget about a price tag.
When did you learn to sing like that?
It started all from Tonga. My grandma, she used to join the church choir. So she would always take me to church, took me to practice and stuff. So yeah, she forced me into singing.
And you've auditioned for what?
The X Factor.
How are you going?
It's going pretty well.
What's school like for you here at Holroyd compared to what it was like in Tonga?
To be in Holroyd is such a pleasure. In Tonga, they judge you based on your exam result at the end of the year, so it's pretty hard. And also the teachers, pretty tough.
Okay, and what are they like here?
They're amazing. They're just too heavenly.
Anton, why did you come to Holroyd?
Because this was the only school that accepted me when I got kicked out.
And why was that?
Fighting disobedience, not listening to teachers, chanting, yeah.
And do you still do those things?
No, when I came here, the school changed me. I was shocked when I came here, no one jigged. They always went to class. So I was like, no one to jig with, so I just might as well go to class as well. And when I started going to class, it was all right. The teachers kicked back. The teachers act like one of us, so it was mad. Yeah, I was shocked that Holroyd took me.
And do you have a sense of what you'd like to do when you leave school? What year are you in?
11, yeah. Well, my mentor wanted me to go to uni. He's been pushing me and talking me out of bad stuff, and yeah, that's what I want to do, go to uni.
Yeah, and what would you like to do at uni?
Oh, I'm not sure yet.
And the mentor's important? Do you still see the mentor?
Oh, no, he stopped this year because I was going good.
Okay, do you want to go and sit down again, and we'll keep talking to everyone else as well? Thank you so much again for that. It was great. I'd like you to put up your hands, those of you who arrived here by boat as asylum seekers. Okay, let's talk a little bit about that. Bashir, what was the boat trip like for you from Indonesia to Australia?
Well, that was actually was hard. I was on the boat about 7 days and seven nights. We didn't have even water. We didn't have even food for 7 days.
And you were on your own, yeah?
And I was by myself. And then after four or five days, I wasn't even able to talk because I had no energy. Because for 7 days and seven nights, I didn't have any things to eat. And we didn't even have any blanket, any things like that. We came under one T-shirt. We thought, like, it's just going to take 45 hours to get there.
You must have been very frightened.
I was, actually.
Being so
I was
young, yeah?
I was thinking, like, this is the end of my life. This is... I cannot, like... But today, like, I'm here.
You're here?
Yeah.
Yeah. And what are you doing now that you've left school?
Currently, I am studying a diploma of accounting at Australian Business Academy.
And you're doing your citizenship test tomorrow?
Wow. So tomorrow, 9:30, I'll be there.
Okay, we'll keep tabs on that with you. Mahanad, what about you? You're originally from Iraq. You also came to Australia by boat, actually from Iran via Iran, is that right?
That's right,
yeah. With your dad, what was that trip like for you? How old were you when you made the trip?
When I made the trip, I just turned 14, and it was my first time that entering countries and leaving a few countries illegally and by traffickers and human trafficking. And I had such a terrible experience because my dad tried his whole life to put me in the best condition of life with all he had, and he raised me. And then in that moment when I was in Indonesia and in the places that they kept me, and so this could be even more upset that being in this situation and seeing your dad that cannot do anything for you. Like, first day they tell you everything is there, you're safe, you're like that. Just go there, be ready, and everything will be fine. And my trip's supposed to be at least 4 days, and I ended up being 11 days on a boat.
11 days.
11 days I was on the water, and in that 11 days, I was 10 days on that crappy, old, broken, with no blanket, no food, no water, nothing on the boat, but...
Have spent time in detention in Australia or elsewhere, but in detention on the way here. Okay, so quite a few. Mobin?
Yeah.
Tell me about it. What was it like?
Like I said, it was like creepy.
Yeah. Creepy.
Yeah, because
why?
Of the fences and stuff, like around us. I thought I'm gonna be there like for whole my life and I can't see my father anymore.
Okay. What about you, Mohamed? How long were you in detention for?
I was in detention centre for 3 months and 21 days.
Okay, so you counted those days, huh?
Second by second.
And what was it like for you?
First, when I entered, I thought, like, first night they told me you're not allowed to stay in Australia and you have to be transferred to Nauru Island. And first, second, I said, I had all this condition. I left my home, I left whatever I had, all my memories in my country, and to come here and then not acceptance again. And after that, after a while staying in detention center, I started to just stop thinking about this stuff and just put my mind on different things and just thinking maybe about school or spending time with different things, and I ended up being here now.
So what did it feel like when you were released from detention?
Well, my detention center that I spent, it was so small, and like I used to walk so close, like for going to anywhere else in the detention center. And the second I came out, I was so happy. When I sat in the plane, I came to Sydney. When I started walking in the street, the distance went started to become more.
Do the rest of you know these stories about one another?
No.
No, this is my first time. No. No?
This is like one of the new things for a lot of us to hear people open up about this. Like,
yeah.
Sometimes you want to know, but you're not sure if it's the right question to ask, if it brings back bad memories for the people. So, you know, if they feel comfortable, you feel they'll tell you when they are comfortable to let it out.
Mm-hmm. What about some of the rest of you? You said you didn't know some of these stories. Yes.
We've had Mo Bin in our class, and I thought, he's just like
a normal kid.
He's just come in. Yeah, he's got a different background. That's nice. All this stuff. And then now hearing that, I'm just like, oh my gosh, he's
different person.
Yes, thank
but the
you.
The same person at the same time.
He's just like, I'm just like, oh my gosh, he came on a boat. He's had all this terrible stuff happen to him. How did I not know this? He hit it very well.
Okay. So you're all coming to this school with some pretty extraordinary experiences sitting right behind you. I mean, it's a huge thing to do, and it's a huge achievement you've all made to actually be at the school and to be learning and studying and living your lives. How much do those thoughts come into your minds now, and how much are you able to process them? Do you think about it very much?
Yeah.
You think about it, Fahim?
Yeah, I think about it very much because I can't believe I came in Australia. Yeah, that's why every time, every second, it goes to my mind. When I'm going to see my family in Afghanistan, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And so who is in Afghanistan your family?
My big sister, she married and she had two daughters, and my mom.
Your mum's in Afghanistan?
No, my mom's so missing and she wants to go to Afghanistan and to see her.
Oh, to see her daughter.
My father was here, and I, as I told you, like when fight and war start in Syria, and my father forced us to come in Australia because it wasn't safe. Like the situation was really bad. Like people should be there and understand them. I've seen like children, their half and body got cut, like got bombed or get shoot. Like it's really bad. It's really, really bad.
What about you boys? How do you deal with the things that you've been through? Do you talk about it to your friends? Do you talk to family? Do you talk to teachers?
As I said, like I sometimes try to remember myself, who I was, how did I come here, how I felt and how situation I went through. Just for myself, I try not to share stories because I know some people are so emotional and stuff, so it wasn't such a good story coming like this, and so I tried to keep it with myself.
Mm. And why did you want to talk about it tonight?
Tonight I just wanted to say that I came here for moving forward and showing who I am and proving my identity to all the world. So.
Mm.
Because I haven't been accepted in any countries that I went through. So, like, even when I was in Iran, they used to call me an Iraqi boy or something such a unique. As some of the students said, if you are like from different background, you go to an Anglo-Saxon school, you feel a bit different. That's exactly happened to me when I was in Iran. And when I went to Iraq and I had a bit of accent with my Arabic and stuff, and people used to, even the police used to tell me that you're not Iraqi. And this, I just wanted to say, here I'm here today. If I'm not Iraqi, fine. If I'm not Iranian, fine. At least Australia accepted.
Hello, do you mind if I talk about you for a moment?
Is that all right? Okay.
Hello?
You're all right?
Yeah.
Is there anything else you want to say?
Do you want me to say it for you?
Yeah, if you mind.
When I'm talking to students, I'm not talking to them in a harsh way that shows that I'm a superior person, if you like. I'm talking to them with respect because they're fellow human beings and they need that respect, and I expect that back from them.
Dorothy, you've been principal at Holroyd for around 20 years. Denise here, your deputy's been with you for a lot of that time as well. Now, we've just brought you into this conversation now. You've been listening to it so far. The school's had a pretty good rap. Any surprises for you, though, in what you've heard? Are there any things you've heard tonight that you didn't know?
Not really. I think that the stories that the students have told are very typical of a lot of the students here at Holroyd. It's quite a unique school in lots of ways because of the mix of students and because of the harmonious way in which they interact. Be like that.
Yeah, why is that, do you think?
I think we've worked
a lot of schools aren't like that.
I think we've worked really hard over the years to make the school like that. Quite a long time ago, I think the second year I was at the school, we decided that the raft of school rules we had didn't really serve the needs of a school with an emerging complex population. And so basically I got rid of all the school rules, and we spent a year negotiating with the students and the teachers and the parents about how we would organise the ethos of the school, if you like. And we came up with the idea of respect. And then a year later we added responsibility, because you need to have that as the other side of the coin. And
how do you get students then to come to the table on those things?
Well, I think you model that sort of respectful behaviour from the top, so that you can't expect other people to respect you unless you respect them.
Was that transition difficult? I mean, what was the school like when you got there?
It was more like a typical suburban high school. It was not a happy school. It was a school with low achievement, I think, overall. And it was a bit down at the heels and miserable. The whole purpose of the school is to ensure that all the students are going to be successful.
Denise, you're the deputy principal.
Yeah, that's right.
You interview each of the students before they're admitted to the school. Why?
Every student in the IEC is welcome to apply for the high school. They're told from the beginning that if they wish to come to Holroyd High School, and we're very open about it, that they have to want to learn and that they have to comply with school rules. We're also believe in giving people a second chance. And that's how a lot of our, I suppose, more local enrolments like Anton came to us. Students who've been unsuccessful at other schools. We don't take every one of those. We weigh up.
So how do you make that assessment? How do you?
That's why I have an interview.
Okay.
And I have to have the parent or guardian or whoever there. And often we go with our gut instinct.
Who else had been in trouble somewhere else at another school before they came? Yep.
In my previous school, I got suspended about four to five times, like, every year. And then I...
45
No.
What sorts of things?
Like, swearing at the teacher. This was at my previous school. Getting into fights. I even once threw a chair across the room and it almost hit someone. And I got suspended to the point where I couldn't handle it anymore. So I begged my dad to move me to Holroyd because my sister attended. And then I came to the interview. I was really nervous because I thought they're not going to take me because of my behaviour. But then out of my luck, they accepted me. And then ever since then, I've loved every minute of Holroyd.
And Ted, you've been bullied at school badly at the other school.
I was harassed. I came home crying each time with tears inside. I've had like a horrible, horrible experience. I came to Holroyd and I literally just love every single second I have there. It's literally amazing.
Okay. Are we okay here?
I'm not sure.
Hello, do you mind if I talk about you for a moment?
Is that all right? Okay.
Hello.
You all right?
Yeah.
Is there anything else you want to say?
Do you want me to say it for you?
Yeah, if you mind.
Right. Halau has made an enormous journey. I actually teach Halau this year, and I think he's finding that an interesting experience too. And I have to say, I'm pretty sure, Halau, I suspended you a couple of times along the way. Anton's been suspended at least once by me as well. We have very strict code of behaviour, and there are certain lines in the sand that we're not prepared for them to cross.
Okay, what did you want to say, Mohamed?
Miss Carrick, as she said, like, she's one of the most strict person at the school, but I'm having her as a legal studies student in her class. She's the absolutely opposite person in the classroom. So, like, even students, if do mistakes, she's so calm and stuff, but if you see her at recess, absolutely zero tolerance. You're not
I just wanted to add that before, I thought Miss Carrick was really unfair to me, but then I've had her like since the start of this year, and I love her. She's like really good.
I'm gonna cry, Ravina. Okay, this is turning into a love in now. Yeah, Dorothy, what did you want to say?
We use what's called restorative justice principles in the school. The idea is that you help the child to take responsibility for what they've done, to confront what they've done, to look at it, to acknowledge it, and then they have to find the way to repair the damage. They have to acknowledge that. We don't blame the child. It's not simply punishing someone. It is saying, you are part of a solution to this. And that is an important part of what we do.
Dorothy, you give the students some other advice about love. What is it?
Oh, yeah. Year 12 know about this. Every year when we have our first year meeting, I say to year 12, now you've got to work very hard. And it's really important this year that you don't fall in love because it gets in the way of a good HSC result.
Well, good luck with that. I mean, how well does that work? Everyone?
Phenomenal.
They're too scared to fall in love for the most part.
They're too scared
and,
by the principal.
And our HSC results are very good. Can I say that that last year's HSC class, 54% have gone to university.
And wow. How does that compare with the state average?
The national average is just over 30% for all students.
So 54% of your kids went to university last year.
And some of those students have been in Australia, as you can see, only a very short time.
Let's just finish off by talking a little bit about what you all would like to do after school. Who'd like to kick that off? Maria, what about you? What would you like to do?
I want to be an obstetrician, but firstly I want to be a midwife because I really, really like kids and babies.
What about some of the rest of you? What would you like to do? Hilal?
I would love to be a biomedical scientist. So I've always aspired to be a scientist one day. When I was a little kid, I used to always tell my dad, Dad, I want to be a scientist one day. And then he would tell me, son, you can do anything if you believe.
Mahalo, what would you like to do?
I want to finish year 12 and then try to get to university for studying a double degree of business and law.
And what about you, Mobin? What would you
Well,
like?
I want to be an actor. Like ice cube.
All right, Zabi, what about you? What would you like to do?
I want to do accounting and business as well.
Business?
Yes.
Yeah? Bolsha?
I want to be a teacher or a doctor.
Zara, what about you? What would you like to do?
I want to be a fashion designer. It's my dream.
And what do you want to do when you leave school? Do you have ideas about what you'd like to do?
Yeah. I don't know. I want to be a lawyer.
Yeah?
Mm. Yeah. My dad said he wants to be a doctor.
Yeah?
And I don't like doctor like you. we're doing a lot of science and we're doing a lot of tests. And I think I can become a lawyer because it's much easier than doctor.
Mm.
Yeah.
Anyone else? Yes, Sammy.
Well, my parents set a high standard. They wanted me to go into becoming a doctor or biomedical engineer, but I'm not going to do that. First of all, I was thinking of policing, but then I searched into it and I wanted to become a psychologist so I can help people like Mohamed and all these guys like, their problems. I don't mean that in any offensive
no,
way. But,
no, yeah. No, you don't. Absolutely, you don't. It's a great thing you want to do. Anyone else? Yes, lots and lots. Okay, Taniela.
I want to become a singer because I love Beyonce.
All right. Just before we wrap up, what about the future of these kids? Such great aspirations, so much they want to do. How secure is their future here, given that they're, you know, on a range of different visas and, you know, have in a range of different situations at the moment?
On a day-to-day level and as teachers, where you have, in our school, nearly 20% of students who are on community detention or bridging visas, to think that they still come to school giving 100% and committing themselves to learning where they have a fear still of the unknown, not knowing if they're going to be able to stay permanently, to be continually still living in fear of that brings more complex issues on a day-to-day basis for them and for the teachers and the staff that are working at school.
Jenny, young people should be looking to the future. And people who are in their teens and finishing school should be arranging their lives for the future. They should be thinking about what they're going to study, what work they're going to have, how they're going to meet the right person and marry and have children and settle into adult life. They shouldn't be denied that possibility.
All right, we'll leave it there. Holroyd High, thank you very much indeed for joining Insight tonight. It's been great to meet you all and terrific to hear your stories. And that is all we had time for this week, but let's keep talking on Twitter and on Facebook.
Yeah, I don't think my parents knew how good they had it until they had Jenny.
But your sense of competition, how would you describe that?
Oh, it's there, yeah.
They'll compete about who's got the most cereal in a bowl. And
if you had to choose a favourite, could you name one?
Alex. I sniff him all the time. There's some sort of smell connection.
We'll be back next week. Stay tuned now for Dateline. Thanks, everybody. It was great.